लेट्स स्टार्ट लेसन 8 गुलिवर एट लिलीपुट। हेलो, माय नेम इज गुलिवर। आई वाज द थर्ड सन अमंग द फाइव ऑफ माय फादर। ही हैड अ स्मॉल एस्टेट इन नॉटिंगहमशायर इन नॉर्थ इंग्लैंड। आई स्टडीड मेडिसिन इन लंदन एंड हॉलैंड। आई मैरिड मैरी बर्टन, द सेकेंड डॉटर ऑफ अ मर्चेंट इन लंदन एंड प्रैक्टिस्ड मेडिसिन। I used to read books on navigation as I wanted to travel and see the world. As a doctor, I was a failure, so I took an appointment as a doctor on board. It set sail from Bristol on 4th May 1699. We were making a voyage to the South Sea. In November, we were on our way to the East Indies. It was summer in these parts. Suddenly, a terrible storm broke out and drove us to the northwest of Van Diemen's Land near Australia. It was misty all over and we could not see things clearly. Antelope struck with a big rock and broke into pieces. All the sailors and passengers got into boat. We fought the waves with our oars for a long time. The sea grew rougher and in about half an hour the waves turned the boat upside down. Now I could not see my friend. I began to swim. The waves and the wind carried me over some distance. Now I could see an island at some distance, but no strength was left in my limbs to swim. I gave up all hopes of life and let my legs drop. To my great surprise, I found that the sea was not deep there. My feet could touch the floor and my head was above water. I walked in water. Slowly and slowly, I reached the shore. I walked on the seaside for some distance. Now, I was too tired to move. I sat down and breathed deeply. I closed my eyes and lay down on the ground. I slept soundly for a long time. When I opened my eyes, sun rays were falling on my face. I tried to get up steps. I could not move. I found that a number of strings held my arms and legs tightly. I felt something crawling on my chest up to my chin. It was a human being not more than 6 inches tall. He had a bow and arrow in his hand. Soon, many of them reached on my chest. Now, I could realize that these little men had made me their prisoner. I tried a lot to pull my left arm free from the cords that they tied it. As I tried to catch them, the little men ran back. Some of them jumped to the ground in terror. Soon, a lot of arrows come flying at my left hand. They pricked me like many needles. So, I decided that it would be wise to be quiet and not move. Then, they stopped the shooting. Soon, I started feeling hungry. I kept putting my finger to my open mouth. This was a sign that I wanted food. They were intelligent men. They moved a number of ladders to my side. About 100 little men climbed up the ladders and walked towards my mouth with many baskets full of food. I ate 3 loaves of bread at a time. All the time, they gave little cries of wonder at my size and appetite. Then they opened the barrels of drink into my mouth. I drank one barrel in one gulp and demanded more. Again, there were shouts of joy and wonder. Then they removed the pains from my body and rubbed a medicine. They had mixed a sleep-giving drug in my drink. I felt estate again. In the meanwhile, they made a long cart to carry me to the capital. They lifted me onto the carriage with the help of ropes passing over the pulley. Then they tied me to the carriage. 1500 of king's horses, each about 4.5 inches high, pulled the carriage to the capital. While the carriage was on the way, two soldiers climbed up on my face to look me closely. One of them stuck his spear a good way in my nose. It tickled like a frog and made me sneeze loudly. The little soldiers fled in terror. The carriage reached the capital next day at noon. The king, the queen, and all his court came to see me. Thousands of citizens gathered to have a look of mine. When they saw that I did not mean to do them any harm, they untied my cords. They allowed me to stand up, but they took care to chain my left foot with 90 chains. The priest and lawyers spoke to me. I also spoke to them in as many languages as I knew. Neither they nor I could understand each other's language. I showed gestures of respect to the king, the queen, and the officers. So the king was pleased very much. The king ordered for the arrangement of my food and house. 6 teachers were appointed to teach me the language of the country. I made great progress in my learning. In a few weeks, I was able to converse with the king. I lived happily among the little people. They were learned men. In skill and grace, the Lilliputians were far above the men in every other country. I held the king of Lilliput against a war waged by the neighboring king of Blefusu. At this, the king of Lilliput conferred on me the title of Nayadok, the highest honor in the kingdom of Lilliput. 3 weeks later, the king of Blefusu sent messengers of peace to Lilliput. They invited me to their kingdom. I asked the king of Lilliput for his permission. He said yes, very reluctantly. The Blefusudians welcomed me. I enjoyed their food, drinks, songs, and dances. 3 days after my arrival, I saw a boat on the shore. I got it repaired with the help of their workers. Meanwhile, some officials of Lilliput advised their king to get me prisoner for going to Blefusu. Apparently, they put other false charges against me and sent a messenger to the king of Blefusu to get me prisoner and sent back to Lilliput. The king of Blefusu refused them. I begged the king of Blefusu to return to my country. He agreed, though he offered me his protection. He gave me enough food for the journey, gold coins, and other gifts. When the wind was fair, I set sail for home. Before long, a big ship picked me up and carried me to England. I arrived in England on the 14th of April 1702. Everyone at the ship and in England did not believe my story. They would cry, "Come, come, good sir, surely you have been dreaming." Then I showed them some tiny cattle which I had brought home along with me. And they had nothing to say, nothing but stare at me. Let's start lesson 9, A Moonbeam Comes. Deep in the night, when all is still, a moonbeam climbs the window sill. Over your bed, it softly flies to see if sleep has closed your eyes. A pinch of gold, some fairy sand, is clasped within that moonbeam's hand. And if by chance you are not asleep, it comes tiptoe on gentle feet. to touch your eyes with golden beams and take you to the land of dreams. Let's start Lesson 10, Knowledge House. Library is a place where we find collection of books, CDs, newspapers, etc. They are there for people to read, study or borrow. It may be a small collection made by one person for himself to read, or it may be a very large one that needs a separate building to itself. The person who is in charge of a library and looks after it is called librarian. The important kinds of libraries are school and public libraries. School libraries are now an essential part of the school. They are now as important as laboratories and gymnasium. A good school library has a collection of books of special interest to students, such as sports, travel, science, literature, art. Along with such books, there will be a collection of storybooks for children of all age groups. The reference section includes encyclopedias, atlas, dictionaries, and all the resources which a teacher or a student may need to draw material from for wider knowledge on particular subjects. Even the best school library, however, will not be able to answer all these questions or provide enough books for students who enjoy reading. So, the next step is to use the public library. Every town and city has a public library, and even in certain villages, there are branches of libraries. The fee of public libraries is free, and anyone can join by signing a form and promising to keep the rules and take care of books borrowed. Some libraries allow only two books to be borrowed at one time, while in others there is no limit. All books are recorded when borrowed. This is done by keeping the reader's ticket. Now, computers are used to keep records of books. The borrowed books show the date by which it must be returned, which is usually 2 or 3 weeks. It is not fair to keep books for which other may be waiting. There are special sections for newspapers and magazines in most of the libraries. Some libraries also lend audio and video cassettes. The reference section of a library is a place for study, and if you disturb other readers, you will get a reprimand from the librarian. To save you from the trouble of copying out information, many libraries have a photocopying machine so that by paying nominal charges, you can get required information from the books. One of the problems facing by modern libraries is that with more and more books and periodicals being published, libraries are becoming too large. One solution is to record on microfilm, which is often done with newspapers. Another is the use of microcards, on which the whole book is printed. But for the ordinary reader, printed books are more convenient to read and to handle. Let's start Lesson 11, Kalpana Chawla. Kalpana Chawla was the first Indian woman to go into space. In her 2 voyages into space, she spent 17 days and 16 hours in the space respectively. There is no air or water in space. She was an astronaut on the Columbia Space Shuttle. Shuttle means a form of transport that travels regularly between 2 places. Columbia Space Shuttle was designed for going into space and come back and land on the runway like an aeroplane. It had its first flight in 1981. The early spacecraft sent to the moon were destroyed, and the astronauts came down in the Pacific Ocean. Kalpana was born on 1st July 1961 in Karnal, a small town of Haryana in India. She was the youngest among three sisters and one brother. She was admitted in Tagore Balniketan School, Karnal in 1968. In school days, Kalpana was confined to her studies only. She paid more attention to her homework rather than playing out. When she became adolescent, she took interest in painting, sports, and cultural programs. She loved being outdoors, liked to go on hiking or cycling. She loved the wind on her face. There was a big neem tree in the courtyard of the school. During recess, she used to sit under it. Whenever she heard the noise of an aeroplane above, she looked at the sky for long, even after the aeroplane flight passed. On asking, she told her friends that she too wanted to fly in the sky and see what is there on the moon and stars. Kalpana's brother Sanjay Chawla joined the flying club of Karnal. He was taking training to become a commercial pilot. At that time, Kalpana has reached in class 12 in Dayal Singh College, Karnal. She applied for the membership of the flying club, but her father did not allow her. It was the year 1978. The same year, she appeared for pre-engineering test and selected for admission to Punjab Engineering College, Chandigarh. As Kalpana was so excited about flying, she chose the branch of aeronautical engineering for study. Mere excitement could do nothing. It was her attitude. Everyone in her family believed that hard work would get you what you wanted. If you were determined, you could follow your dreams, no matter how difficult they are. To keep on trying and never give up was her life mantra. Kalpana was proceeding fast on her trek towards her dream. In 1982, she topped in the university examination of aeronautical engineering. In her pursuit for flying and reaching space, she took admission in the master's course in aerospace engineering in Texas in the United States of America. Her father reluctantly allowed her to go foreign. Kalpana was overjoyed to get the subject and place of her choice. At the same time, she was somehow nervous about the entirely new circumstances. In her study mania, Kalpana did not know the time passing away. She got the master's degree in aerospace engineering in 2 years. In 1984, she started research work at Colorado University in computational fluid dynamics. She completed her doctorate in 1988. Meanwhile, she learned flying aeroplanes and got a license for private pilot. It was mere chance that when she was on her first independent flight, her mother was the first passenger of her plane. Kalpana married with an American engineer, J.P. Harrison. He worked as a freelance flight trainer at NASA, National Aeronautics Space Administration. NASA is the organization that conducts most space trips of the world. She applied for American citizenship. She got the citizenship, but she always told people, "I belong to Karnal, Haryana in India." She used to listen Indian music and learn Indian dances. Immediately after completing her doctorate, Kalpana got an offer for work at MCAT, Institute of California, as a research scientist. MCAT was affiliated to NASA, so Kalpana could have a chance to become an astronaut. She purchased a small plane of her own and got a license as a glider pilot. She also followed her hobbies of skiing, mountaineering, and space photography. In December 1994, Kalpana was selected by NASA for being trained as an astronaut. She was among the 6 candidates selected among the 2,962 competitors. She was sent for training to Johnson Space Center in the 15th group of astronauts. After 1 year's training, she was found fit for the job. On 19 November 1997, Kalpana went into space on Columbia STS-87 from Kennedy Space Center, Houston, Florida. There were 6 people on board. one commander, one pilot, two mission specialist and two PELOD, spacewalk specialist. Kalpana was mission specialist number one. After doing many observations and experiments in space for 17 days, 16 hours and 32 minutes, she returned on 5th December 1997. Kalpana had realized her dream. Columbia Space Shuttle STS-87 was repaired and overhauled in 1999. STS means Space Transport Station. It took its first flight in space in 1981. But its first important mission took place in 1991 when it took a laboratory and 9 scientists on board. It could land on a runway like an aeroplane. Kalpana was selected for one more space program. Her sharp intelligence, working style, courage, and patience and perseverance helped her to get a place. It was the 28th flight of the Columbia Space Shuttle. Kalpana and 6 other astronauts started on their STS-107 mission on 16th January 2003. This time, the research scientists studied the insects, fishes, crystals, waves, fire along with themselves in space for 16 days. They all were in weightless position. The shuttle went round the Earth at 9 distance of 277 km. It was moving at about 28,325 km per hour. After completing their work, the scientists started to return to Earth. The shuttle was programmed for it. It was 1st February 2003. Just 15 minutes before its landing, the Columbia shuttle burst into pieces. All the world was watching Columbia coming down. Now, what they could see was only flames. All the people paid their tributes to the astronauts who worked for the mankind. Kalpana's dream was fulfilled, but she was no more to enjoy its fruits for long. Even now, Kalpana is alive in our hearts and her words too. It is so exciting to go around the Earth, to look at it roll by and by the speed at which it goes. It looks beautiful and wonderful, and her wishes are for the future astronauts. Let's start Lesson 12, Barter. Life has loveliness to sell, all beautiful and splendid things. Blue waves whitened on a cliff, soaring fire that sways and sings. And children's faces looking up, holding wonder like a cup. Life has loveliness to sell, music like the curve of gold, scent of pine trees in the rain, eyes that love you, arms that hold. And for your spirit still delight, holy thoughts that star the height. Spend all you have for loveliness, buy it and never come to the cost. For one by thinking hour of peace, count many a year of strife well lost. And for a breath of ecstasy, give all you have peace or good peace. Let's start Lesson 13. Rajam and Money. River Sariu was the pride of Malgudi. It was some 10 minutes walk from Elaman Street, the last street of the town, chiefly occupied by oil mongers. Its sandbanks were the evening resort of all the people of the town. The usual evening crowd was on the sand. Swaminathan and Money sat aloof on a river step with their legs dangling in the water. It was some 15 minutes past sunset and there was a soft red in the west. "The water runs very deep here, doesn't it?" Money asked. "Yes." "Why?" said Swami. "I'm going to bring Rajam here. Bundle him up and throw him into the river." "Rajam," said Money, was a fresh arrival in the first. He had sauntered into the class on the reopening day of the second term, walked up to the last bench, sat beside Money and felt very comfortable indeed, till Mani gave him a jab in the ribs, which he returned. He had impressed the whole class on the very first day. He was a newcomer. He dressed very well. He was the only boy in the class who wore socks and shoes, a fur cap and tie, and a wonderful coat and knickers. He came to the school in a car. As well as all this, he proved to be a very good student too. There were vague rumors that he had come from some English boys' school somewhere in Madras, Chennai. He spoke very good English, exactly like a European, which meant that few in the school could make out what he said. This Rajam was a rival to Mani. If Mani jabbed, Rajam jabbed. If Mani clouted, he clouted. If Mani kicked, he kicked. If Mani was the overlord of the class, Rajan seemed to be nothing less. And add to all this fact that Rajam was a regular 70%er, second only to Shankar. There were sure indications that Rajam was the new power in the class. Day by day, as Mani looked on, it was becoming increasingly clear that a new maniac had appeared in his life. All this lay behind his decision on the river step to bundle up Rajam and throw him into the river. Swaminathan expressed a slight fear. You forget that his father is the police superintendent. Mani remained silent for a while and said, What do I care? Some right, I am going to crack his shoulders with my club. If I were you, I would keep out of the way of a policeman. They are an awful lot, said Swaminathan. If you were me, huh? But thank God, I am not you. A milk-toothed coward like you, Swaminathan bit his lips and sighed. Swaminathan was to act as a cord of communication between Rajan and Mani. They were sitting on the last bench with their backs against the yellow wall. Swaminathan sat between Rajam and Mani. Their books were before them on the desk, but their minds were busy. Mani wrote on a piece of paper, Are you a man? And gave it to Swaminathan, who pushed it across to Rajam, putting on as offensive a look as possible. Rajam read it, crumpled it, and threw it away. At which Mani wrote another note repeating the question, with the addition, You are the son of a dog if you don't answer this, and pushed it across. Rajam hissed into Swaminathan's face, You scoundrel, don't disturb me, and crumpled the letter. Further progress was stopped. Swaminathan, stand up, said the teacher. Swaminathan stood up faithfully. What is Lisbon famous for? Asked the teacher. Swaminathan hesitated and ventured for being the capital of Spain. The teacher bit his moustache and fired a second question. What do you know about the Indian climate? It is hot in summer and cold in winter. Stand up on the bench, roared the teacher. And Swaminathan stood up without a protest. He was glad that he was given the supposedly degrading punishment instead of the cane. Swaminathan paid no attention to the rest of the lesson. When the work for the day was over, Swaminathan, Mani and Rajam adjourned to a secluded spot to say what was in their minds. Swaminathan stood between them and acted as a medium of communication. They were so close that they could have heard each other even if they had spoken in whispers. But it was a matter of form between enemies to communicate through a medium. Mani faced Swaminathan steadily and asked, Are you a man? Swaminathan turned to Rajam and repeated, Are you a man? Rajam flared up and shouted, Which dog doubts it? Swaminathan turned to Mani and said ferociously, Which dirty dog doubts it? Have you the courage to prove that you are a man? Asked Mani. Swaminathan turned to Rajam and repeated it. How? 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 Repeated Swaminathan to Mani. Meet me at the river near Nalappa's grove tomorrow evening. Near Nalappa's grove? Swaminathan was pleased to echo. What for? Asked Raja. To see if you break my head. Oh, to pieces? Said Raja. Swaminathan's services were dispensed with. They gave him no time to repeat their words. Rajam shouted in one ear and Mani in the other. So, we may expect you at the river tomorrow, said Swaminathan. Yes, Rajam assured them. Mani wanted to know if the other would come with guards. No, he would not, and Mani voiced another doubt. If anything happens to you, will you promise to keep it out of your father's knowledge? Rajam promised, after repudiating the very suggestion that he might act otherwise. Nalappa's group stood a few yards before them. It was past six and the traffic for the day between the banks was over. The usual evening crowd was far behind them. Swaminathan and Mani were squatting on the sand. They were silent. Mani was staring at the ground with a small wooden club under his arm. He was thinking he was going to break Rajam's head in a short while and throw his body into the river. But if it should be recovered? But then, how could they know that he had done it? But if Rajam should conk and trouble him at night as a spirit? Since his grandfather's death, he was sleeping alone. What if Rajam should come and pull his hair at night? It would be better not to kill him after all. He would content himself with breaking his limbs and leaving him to his fate. If he should batter his head, who going to find it out? Unless, of course, he cast a sly look at Swaminathan, who was blinking innocently. Unless, of course, Swaminathan informed the police. At the sound of the creaking of boots, they turned and found that Rajam had come. He was dressed in khaki and carried under his arm an air gun that was given to him a couple of months ago on his birthday. He stood very stiff and said, Here, I am ready. You are late. Yes, we will start. Rajam shouldered his gun and fired a shot in the air. Mani was startled. He stood still, his club down. You heard the shot? Asked Rajam. The next is going to be into your body if you are keen upon a fight. But this is unfair. I have no gun while you have. It was to be a hand-to-hand fight. Then why have you brought your club? You never said anything about it yesterday. Mani hung down his head. What have I done to offend you? Asked Raja. You called me a sneak before someone. That is a lie. There was an awkward pause. If this is all the cause of your anger, forget it. I won't mind being framed, nor I, said Mani. Swaminathan gasped in astonishment. In spite of his posing before Mani, he admired Rajam intensely and longed to be his friend. Now, this was the happiest conclusion to all the unwanted trouble. He danced with joy. Rajam lowered his gun and Mani dropped his club. To show his goodwill, Rajam pulled out of his pocket half a dozen biscuits. The river's mild rumble, the rustling of the people leaves, the half light of the late evening, and the three friends eating and growing with new friendship. Swaminathan felt at perfect peace with the world. A story from Malgudi school days by R.K. Narayan.